When anything new comes out, especially in the tech space, I think the knee-jerk reaction is certainly to not like it. But I think ultimately the real test is the test of time. How well do you look back on a piece of technology after you've used it for a couple of months, or a couple of years, or a couple of decades? I have been wrong a lot. So the nature of technology is it always is evolving, it's always changing. And generally speaking, that's a good thing, right? However, generally speaking, as humans, we don't like change, right? I like a better version of the thing I have right now, but when I don't like even something as simple as the look of that new thing, oftentimes people's reaction is, ugh, I don't want that, that's new, that's weird, that's different. But at the end of the day, technology is always evolving, and if you try to fight that, you're gonna be on the wrong side of history. And believe me when I say, I've been wrong many, many times.
So, as I'm excited to announce, I will be moving all of my video content over to MySpace.
A perfect example of this is the PS5 controller. So when I first saw the DualSense and made my video, in the span of a couple hours, my opinion started to evolve, right? I mean, yeah, sure, at first I was like, oh, this thing is super ugly. And of course, the internet does what the internet does best. Take a very in-depth, careful look at the deeply important and well-thought-out aesthetics of the PlayStation 5 DualSense controller. Yeah. But the thing is, the first impressions are very rarely the final impressions that anyone lands on, right? Sure, if something is horrifically ugly, you're probably gonna think it's horrifically ugly for a while. But the problem is that we get so used to change, and we get so used to years down the line of like, wait, people didn't like that at the beginning? Really? It's weird, right? I can't quite put my finger on why I feel like the DualSense looks odd, and I still feel like this. My first impression was like, ugh. I mean, sure, it's nice that it has all these cool new features and blah, blah, blah. I'm sure as soon as I use it, I'll like, oh, this is great. I love it way more than the Xbox. But Sony have pretty much thrown out the playbook and completely designed something different here. There have been many, many examples of technology that, sure, nowadays we look back and think very fondly of like, this was revolutionary, this was amazing, this is sort of something that was a real game changer. When it first came out, between the design, between the functionality, people straight up hated it. So I've actually never used one of the original Macs before. Macintoshes? What's the singular? It's the first one, so that. And it truly is one of the most important computers of all time. It also was a computer that a lot of people absolutely hated when it first came out. And a big reason for that is this little invention called the mouse. Now, while the Macintosh was certainly not the very first computer to ship with a mouse, it was one of the first computers to heavily take advantage of it throughout the interface. And if I may read a quote here from John C. Dvorak for the San Francisco Examiner, "Apple makes the arrogant assumption of thinking that it knows what you want and need. It unfortunately leaves the why out of the equation," as in, why would I want this? The Macintosh uses an experimental pointing device called a mouse. There is no evidence that people want to use these things. I don't want to use one of these newfangled devices. So as you can see, a glowing reception for the revolutionary new interface known as the mouse back in 1984. So why don't we pull some Marty McFly action and put myself back in this time period and see really how far this computer has come and how well it's aged 35 years, 36 years later. So, I know how to turn this on. I'm sure it's very simple. Okay. If I was a power button, where would I be? I mean, you wouldn't put a power button on the back, would you? I mean, that would be a silly thing to do. So this is embarrassing. I didn't think it would be that difficult. How do you operate a Macintosh? Well, wow, there's a manual to how to use the manual. There's a switch on the back. So, a cut right here, so we're just gonna make it look like I knew all of that and then we should cut straight into it. Look, I figured out how to do it on my first try. You can do all your work on Macintosh except type text and numbers with 5 mouse techniques. I like how they had to specifically point out that you can't type text and numbers with the mouse. These were very different times. Click, press, drag, double click, and shift click. I'm actually impressed that shift click was a thing even in 1984. So if I want to do something, I'll click and then I'll hover over something and then release. Oh, wait for it. The Macintosh Finder, version 1.1, 1984 Apple computer. This is a good example of something that, because it was so ahead of its time, became the standard, and then 30 something years later, it feels natural to use, right? But people back when this first came out were very, very much not on board because it was something so different, right? I mean, you have to consider, this is back in the days where an operating system looked like this.
Global thermonuclear war.
Not like this. And I think it's interesting to think about just how far something can evolve based on how it changes the future technology that we all get used to, right? Yeah, this thing may have seemed crazy with its expensive price tag and its weird mouse interface that Steve Jobs forces you to use, but ultimately it was the better way of using a computer, and therefore everything since then has been influenced by this computer in one way or another. Thankfully, everyone has learned from their mistakes, and no one has ever criticized a brand new revolutionary input device again.
And it doesn't appeal to business customers because it doesn't have a keyboard, which makes it not a very good email machine.
Something that I think is really easy to forget is that there are huge teams of people who design all aspects of the tech that we use on a regular basis, right? That PS5 controller probably has dozens, if not hundreds, of people on the team. There are many reasons for each and every individual decision of why it had to be this shape, why they had to fit this component inside, and ultimately what they wanted it to look like, right? And while, yes, it's easy for me to make a video and say, ha ha, it looks dumb, or someone to make a meme of, oh, look, it looks like it's in a tank top, but there's ultimately a lot more work that goes into these things, and while there's certainly nothing wrong with criticism, it's certainly not an even balance, right? It's easy to make a quick joke about something, throw it up on Twitter and get a ton of likes, but it's a lot harder to actually make something. Xbox certainly isn't immune to the criticism that Sony has been receiving on the DualSense controller. I mean, sure, when the Xbox Series X was first unveiled, everyone was like, yo, is that a refrigerator? And I personally think that Dave probably had it best, but like with all of these things, and especially with the Series X, because we've actually seen it for quite a while and we've actually done like sort of hands-on and stuff with it, you pretty quickly get used to it, right? Like, yes, it's a little bit of a different shape, but you know what? Maybe all consoles will be vertical in a couple of years. And there are certainly reasons why that makes sense for heat, all of that kind of stuff. It's sort of one of the things that we've already started to get used to. And when you look back at some of the older consoles, like the Xbox One, well, people really, really didn't like that one. Now, yes, over time, I feel like the Xbox One design has certainly grown on me, but well, the internet remembers all, and I have some wonderful comments about how much people really liked the Xbox One design. I don't understand how people are liking this design. It's horrid. It looks like an old VCR player or one of those really old, massive, boxy Motorola PVRs. And the whole checkers look with black and white patterns, it's one of the worst designs I think I've ever seen for a new piece of tech. The thing is bigger than the original Xbox. Ugh. Ugh. Honestly, you could probably swap out the word Xbox for PS5, and a lot of this stuff would definitely apply. For example, no, it's repulsive. I get it, it just looks like a badly made fan mockup that was accidentally selected in an email asking which design would be best. It belongs in a bad anime 80s design inspired pipe dream. Look, man, people are salty about change. Now, there's nothing wrong with being salty about something being different. And there's certainly designs that have aged better than others. But at the end of the day, I guarantee you that no one looks back at the Xbox One and goes, oh, I can't believe that was so horrible. Everyone's just like, oh yeah, it was a little bit big. Oh yeah, the glossy plastic didn't look great. But who cares, right? And this too shall pass. The thing is, people don't understand what's important, what's revolutionary, what changes the way that we use technology until you have the benefit of hindsight, right? And I think a great example of this is the original iPod. When this thing first came out, surprise, surprise, people weren't thrilled about an incredibly expensive MP3 player that only worked with Macs. But, well, it turned out to be kind of a bit of a big deal. You can trace a pretty much direct path from the launch of the original iPod in 2001 to where Apple is today. iPhone absolutely sprang straight out of the iPod project. You have the iPad, you have all of the modern computing, specifically when you look at smartphones that we expect and we use today, a lot of it really drew its inspiration from the iPod. But of course, people don't remember how important things are in the moment, and one of my favorite things is, we were able to find some comments from literally the live blog where they announced the iPod. iPod? I poop. I cry. I was so hoping for something more. That was deep. I felt that one on a really spiritual level. This isn't revolutionary. I still can't believe this. All this hype for something so ridiculous. Who cares about an MP3 player? I want something new. I want them to think differently. Why, oh why would they do this? It's so wrong, it's so stupid. Sounds very revolutionary to me, angry face emoji. Hey, here's an idea, Apple. Rather than enter the world of gimmicks and toys, why don't you spend a little bit more time sorting out your pathetically expensive and crap server lineup? Or are you really just aiming to become a glorified consumer gimmicks firm? Well, Pants, the Mac Rumors regular, I would argue that Apple probably made the right decision on not focusing on the servers and becoming a glorified consumer gimmicks firm that is currently the most expensive and rich company that the world has ever seen since like the East India Company. But that's a This Is episode, don't worry about that, that channel's dead now. To be fair, I have not used an iPod in many years and I've never used the original. So one of the things that jumps out to me is I like the click wheel because this actually has a physically spinning wheel and it has the physical buttons all the way around. So later iPod models, the vast majority of iPod models that most people bought, this was all a capacitive touch interface. So of course the original iPod had a black and white display which was of perfectly reasonable quality for if you're trying to listen to your music, but when it comes to displaying anything that's not black and white. Wow, I just can't believe how smeary the ball is. So screens have come a long way since 2001. But you know what I'm doing is I'm doing really good right now and I'm pretty proud of that because I haven't played Breakout in a long time. The first generation iPod is a great example of the seed of an idea. This was not the best purchase perhaps in 2001. There were certainly major issues with it, but the thing is there is a fundamental idea here which ultimately ended up being wildly successful. Was generation one the perfect execution of that? No, but if they would have listened to all the naysayers who are saying that this is the iPoop, then the world would be a very different place. It takes a lot of I'm gonna say forethought, but it takes a lot of commitment to your ideas, right? You have to know that this weird MP3 player would ultimately change the face and turn what was at the time a fairly small computer company into the world's most powerful and rich tech firm in pretty much existence. It's a very unique path that Apple took to sort of go from the iPod to where they are today. So there's a fine line between something which is different and game-changing and different and weird and doesn't catch on, right? So for every 1984 Macintosh or iPod, there's a Zune, there's a Microsoft Ken, there's an HP touchpad, which for whatever reason didn't work out. Now, there's certainly some element of, I don't wanna say out of controlness, but like there's a certain element of this might be a great design, but it fails because the company collapses or because they made some bad decisions on some other aspect. But ultimately, there are a lot of brand new pieces of technology that are always coming out. And there's, between everything that's successful, always a through line of something which legitimately changes the game. Whether it is a new design for smartphones that everyone gets on board with, for example, like the original iPhone. Or maybe it's something as simple as the way that you interact with a touchscreen device, just swiping as opposed to using physical buttons or like a keyboard, right? But regardless of what it is, I feel like there is a really clear line between things that have failed for reasons that were outside of its control and products and services that have worked because they legitimately were ahead of the curve. And while you might not have appreciated it when they first come out, you absolutely rely on them today. Of course, it's not just hardware that people hate change on. Do you remember the old Instagram logo? Seriously, just stop and think about it for a second. Don't you have fond memories of how that logo looked? Wasn't it great? Well, this is what it actually looked like. Yeah. Speaking of, if we take a look at some comments from the day that Instagram changed their logo, why are they changing what is already good? New Instagram logo is terrible. Looks cheap, hashtag Instagram. Does Instagram realize they shouldn't fix something that's not broken? Instagram's new logo looks like the Phillies fanatic took LSD and wants to know why it's missing an I.
Now watch this. The pig, who's the mascot, the fanatic shoots him with a hot dog.
Look, let's all be real for a second. Do you actually prefer the old logo compared to the new one? I will admit that, yeah, at the beginning I didn't, but seriously, do you actually like it more? So I've kind of thought a little bit about specifically the PS5 controller video, right? So that was a video that was our very first video to ever hit number one on trending. It was a very, very popular video. I look at that I made in a few hours, and while I don't think that that video was wildly wrong, I don't think I need to delete it or make a follow-up or anything that's sort of that extreme. But what I do think is that hindsight is important, and it's, I think, very important to think about the way that things age. It's easy to have a knee-jerk reaction, and especially on YouTube and online, it's easy to have a negative reaction to something for karma, for likes, for whatever the case is, right? Because people like hating, right? It's easy to hate, it's not easy to make. And I think that that's something that I try to be more aware of, and I think that that's something that is healthy for everyone to be aware of, is that it takes you 5 seconds to make fun of a thing. It takes someone months and years to make the thing. There's someone who spent a lot of time, there's probably a huge team of someone who spent a lot of time designing that stupid app update, that terrible looking phone, the ugly controller, whatever the case is. And while you might make fun of it today, you never know, 20 years from now, someone like me might be reading your comment off in a video saying, look at this idiot who didn't appreciate the PS5 controller. Well, that one might not go down in history the same way as the iPod, but we'll see.